How profoundly did the Anglo-Saxons change the genetics of the land we call England today, and is this change still felt in the modern English gene pool? Now, the word England literally comes from an Old English word that means the land of the Angles, with the Angles one of the main Germanic tribes, along with the Saxons and the Jutes, who migrated to Britain during the early Middle Ages. Today, people with English ancestry are found across the globe, and our world has been shaped by the English in various ways. For one, English is the international language of our modern world, and English is a Germanic language precisely because of the Anglo-Saxons. So in this video, I want to explore the genetic impact of the Anglo-Saxons on England. Now, quickly for reference before we get into the details, the Anglo-Saxon migrations took place between around the 5th and 7th centuries AD. Germanic tribes, primarily the Angles, Saxons, Jutes, and Frisians, crossed the North Sea from modern-day Germany, Denmark, and the Netherlands. They were initially invited as mercenaries to defend against invasions by the Picts and the Scots. Those annoying Scots, eh? I wouldn't know anything about that. But they soon established their own kingdoms, including Wessex, Mercia, and East Anglia. Now, prior to the Anglo-Saxon migrations, ancient England was primarily dominated by two groups, the Celtic Britons and then the Romans, but we know the Romans basically had little genetic impact on the lands, and as far as the Celtic DNA markers in Britain prior to the Anglo-Saxons, RL21, which is still found in Atlantic Celtic peoples today, was the dominant Y DNA haplogroup amongst them. But how did the Anglo-Saxon migrations change the genetics of ancient England then? Well, the good news is there has actually been some proper research into this, a number of studies. First up is a study that was published in 2016 in Nature Communications that looked at this precise question. They analysed the genomes of 10 ancient individuals who were found close to Cambridge in the east of England, ranging from the late Iron Age to the middle Anglo-Saxon period. By comparing these ancient individuals with hundreds of modern samples from Britain and Europe, this study estimated that on average, the contemporary East English population derives 38% of its ancestry from Anglo-Saxon migrations, which is pretty sizable. This study also found evidence for mixing of migrants and natives in the early Anglo-Saxon period, and that the Anglo-Saxon migrants have close ancestry to modern-day Dutch and Danish populations. However, the story isn't that straightforward, and this study had a number of limitations, with one key limitation being the sample size being very small, of only 10 individuals, 8 of which were female and 2 were male. When examining their DNA haplogroups, the most common maternal lineages, the mitochondrial DNA, were variants of H1 and H2, alongside branches of K1, T2 and U5. The two males carried Y-DNA subclans of RL21, a haplogroup like I mentioned earlier, very much associated with the insular Celts, both historically and today. Now curiously, despite detecting a substantial Anglo-Saxon genetic contribution, the study found no clear shift in haplogroups. The main reason for this though is twofold, sample size and gender distribution. Basically, as I noted earlier, obviously it's quite a small sample size in general, but during the Anglo-Saxon period, the samples from the Anglo-Saxon period were all female, meaning that this study couldn't see any changes in the Y-DNA haplogroups, which often show more dramatic shifts during population migrations and expansions. Additionally, mitochondrial haplogroups in Britain and Western Europe have shown relatively little change since around 5000 to 4000 BC, when the first farmers arrived. This is because haplogroup H, which accounts for nearly half of all maternal lineages in Western Europe, has been dominant for millennia, with the arrival of the first farmers a key event in this dominance, limiting the visibility of more recent demographic shifts in the maternal genetic record. Now, the good news is there was a much larger study done in 2022 that gives us a much more detailed picture of the impact of the Anglo-Saxon migrations. It was published in Nature, and it looked at the Anglo-Saxon migrations and the formation of the early English gene pool. It had a much larger sample size than the previous study, as they analysed 460 medieval Northwestern Europeans, including 278 individuals from England, mainly from the time period 450 to 850 AD. This larger sample size allows us to see how the genetics of ancient England changed in a significant way around this time, and how the haplogroups of the population on the male side changed dramatically because of the Anglo-Saxons. But before we look at the fascinating findings of this study, I would like to quickly thank the sponsor of today's video, Manta Sleep. Now, these videos take a lot of time and energy to make, that's why getting a good night's sleep is essential, and that's where Manta Sleep comes in. Manta Sleep specialise in making premium quality sleep masks and accessories. With their masks engineered to be 100% blackout and comfortable around your eyes. One thing I really like about their masks is that they're fully adjustable, meaning that you can remove and readjust the eye cups to get the perfect fit for you. Manta Sleep masks are also great for travelling, and I used mine to sleep when I was flying to Dubai recently. Please click the top link in the video description below and use the code HISTORY at checkout to get 10% off your order. They also have a 60-day money-back guarantee, and they're running a Valentine's Day offer until the 18th of February, where you can buy any mask and save 50% on any mask accessory, which is great. Thanks to Manta Sleep for sponsoring this video, and now on with the rest of the video. Now, one of the key high-level findings of this study was that there was a substantial increase of continental Northern European ancestry in early medieval England, which is closely related to the early medieval and present-day inhabitants of Germany and Denmark, implying large-scale substantial migration across the North Sea into Britain during the early Middle Ages. This confirms the general findings from this 2016 study as well. However, this 2022 study found that the initial impact of the Anglo-Saxons was much greater than initially thought by many, as the early medieval individuals from eastern England in this study derived up to 76% of their ancestry from the continental North Sea zone, albeit with substantial regional variation and heterogeneity within sites. Now, this figure of 76% is obviously much higher than today of, say, around 38% in eastern England derived from the Anglo-Saxons. But why is this? Well, this 2022 study found that there was an arrival of ancestry related to Iron Age France after the Anglo-Saxons, and this helped to dilute this ancestry a little. Although the study couldn't pinpoint the exact source of this ancestry, one interesting argument they proposed was that it could have been related to the Franks in some way. The authors note that Frankish material culture is evident in regions of southeast England, particularly in Kent and Sussex, and this probably resulted from pulses of immigration or continuous gene flow between eastern England and its neighbouring regions. Now, some of you may be thinking that the Normans could have been involved in some way as well, but the Normans don't seem to have had any major genetic impact on England from the research we have at the moment at least. So it's interesting that this French-like ancestry also played a role in reducing this Anglo-Saxon ancestry over time between then and now, but this study again confirms the general picture that the Anglo-Saxons had a significant impact on the genetics of ancient England and the formation of the early English gene pool. They concluded that their results overwhelmingly support the view that the formation of early medieval society in England was not simply the result of a small elite migration, but that mass migration from afar must also have had a substantial role. Now, this passage speaks to a long-standing debate about the nature and scale of the Anglo-Saxon migrations and its impact on early medieval society, i.e. whether it was a large-scale influx of Anglo-Saxons from continental Europe, or simply a relatively small group of Anglo-Saxon elites who imposed a language, culture and social structures on the existing population. This study obviously found evidence to support the former, a mass migration. Now, the larger sample size of the study allowed us to see how the Y-DNA haplogroups changed over time. The authors note that before the Middle Ages, post-Neolithic individuals from Britain and Ireland carried overwhelmingly the major Y-chromosomal haplogroup R1b-P312, especially the subhaplogroup RL21. By contrast, the early medieval population of England exhibits a substantial fraction of continental-derived haplotypes belonging to haplogroups R1b-U106, R1a-M420, I2a1-L460, and I1-M253, which are commonly found in Northern and Central Europe. So to summarise this a bit, the Anglo-Saxons had a major impact on the genetics of England, or the land we call England today, thanks to the Anglo-Saxons, an impact that is still felt today, particularly in the east of the country, where the Anglo-Saxon impact, the genetic impact, is highest for obvious reasons, just the geography of it. And in general, it's usually summarised at between 10 and 40% Anglo-Saxon ancestry in different parts of England, with it peaking in the east of the country. If we look at a few different maps of the different subclades of R1b today though, we can see the legacy of the Anglo-Saxons in England. Look at this map of R1b-U106, a haplogroup or a subclad of R1b that the Anglo-Saxons had a major role in spreading into England, and which is very much associated with Germanic peoples in general. You can see how high it is in England today and in Northwest Europe, and in places like the Netherlands and parts of Germany, the home of the Anglo-Saxons. It is much lower in parts of Scotland, Ireland and Wales, however. This is because R1B-L21 is more dominant, as L21 is a subclade of R1B, associated more with Atlantic Celtic ancestry, as noted earlier. So the Anglo-Saxons clearly played a major role in the history and the genetic history of England, and England would not be called England today without their migration. Yet the Anglo-Saxons weren't the only influence on the genetics of England. What impact did the Vikings and various other peoples down through history have on the genetic history of England? Well, to find out, please click here. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and hit the bell. Thanks to Manta Sleep for sponsoring this video as well. And I'll put a link below, top link in the video description below. And clicking that link really helps this channel as well. But yeah, thanks again for watching. Please let me know your thoughts in the comments below and I'll see you next time.